Are you struggling to conceive? You have options, and at Piedmont Reproductive Endocrinology Group, we'll make sure you have the guidance and support you need. PREG is known for individualized fertility care that's unique to every patient. We take the time to provide a reassuring and empowering experience because we believe that you deserve nothing less. Let us help you on your journey to parenthood. Visit us at pregonline.com to learn more. Get the guidance and support you need at Piedmont Reproductive Endocrinology Group.
Did you miss your deadline to renew your Medicaid coverage? You can still send your completed annual review form to Healthy Connections Medicaid. You may be assigned to another health plan, but you can ask to come back to First Choice within 60 days of renewed Medicaid eligibility. It's your family. It's your choice. First Choice is the right choice. Renew and choose us. Visit selecthealthofsc.com/renew to learn more.
Welcome, friends, it's the Movie Boom Podcast. Podcast, enjoy the show. Jackie and Brian are talking about the movies. Movie Boom Podcast on the radio.
Welcome to a movie film commentary track. My name is Zaki Hassan, and I'm joined once again by my friend Brian Hall.
Hey, good morning, Zaki.
Good morning. We are here to talk about one of the greatest movies ever made. I'm talking about 1968's Planet of the Apes, Brian.
Let me get back to my device here. I got to re-cue this up. I looked up the wrong one. I looked up the one that no one enjoys watching, the 2001 remake of Planet of the Apes. Hold on one second.
Wait, I think that's the one where... Wait, we did a commentary for the 1968 one already, didn't we?
Oh, this is starting to feel familiar.
Okay, that explains why we're here watching this terrible, terrible movie.
So I was right. I have the right one queued up.
Or the wrong one, depending on your point of view.
A certain point of view.
A certain point of view, if you will. Well, we are, of course, mere days away from the release of War for the Planet of the Apes, which is the third film in 20th Century Fox's rebooted Apes series. And, you know, the last time there was an Apes movie coming out, we watched the classic Apes movie, one of the greatest films ever made, in my humble opinion. And so this time around, we were like, well, we need to do another Apes movie. What can we do? What can we do? And then we somehow landed on this. We threw some poop at the wall.
And this one stuck.
This is the one that stuck. So we are watching, yes, that's right. We're watching the 2001 reboot, or rather reimagining of Planet of the Apes. This one was directed by Tim Burton. It stars Mark Wahlberg. And it's not a very good movie, Brian.
Yeah, I'm really interested to talk through this one with you because you are such a huge fan of the Planet of the Apes series. I mean, and not even just the films. You know the books, you know the comics, you know the TV series. And this, you know, I'm a fan of Tim Burton. I've seen this film. I think most people have seen this film. So I'm personally looking forward to hearing your take on these things and the stories that you have, knowing things I don't know about development and I don't know what went into this movie. So
well, and that's what we're going to do. We'll be talking about the production process. Obviously, we'll also be talking about the development process, which was very lengthy. It spanned almost 15 years from conception to screen for this film, and obviously, it did not turn out well in that it did not launch a new franchise. But I do think it led to hopefully a vehicle for some very interesting conversations. Mm-hmm. So we have the film queued up on both of our ends. So we'll do the usual thing where I will count to three, Brian, and then we will go one, two, three, play. So here we go. Ready? Mm-hmm. One, two, three, play. And there it is, the Fox logo. Mm-hmm. Now, this film came out July 27th, 2001. So about 16 years ago already, although it feels like forever ago and not that long ago.
When you say 16 years, it doesn't seem that long ago for some reason. This movie feels older to me in my mind.
How funny.
Yeah.
Now, you and I saw this together.
Yes. Yes, back in Warrenville, Illinois.
That was the day after it opened, and that was my second time seeing it. So I saw it twice opening weekend.
Yeah. Well, tell me about that, because this obviously, for you, I mean, this is one of your personal favorite series. And so this big hyped up remake comes out. I mean, were you feeling those feelings where you see it once and you don't know how to process it, so you wanted to see it again, or was it just a courtesy to me?
I had PMS when I watched Planet of the Apes 2001. And when I say PMS, I mean Phantom Menace Syndrome.
That's what I was wondering. Yeah.
So I saw it opening night, and I was ecstatic. I was over the moon. I loved it, even though there were parts of it that sort of niggled at me a little bit. But I was like, no, it's great. It's great. It's great. It's still good. It's still good. It's still a little airborne. It's still good.
Right.
And the next day, a couple of friends, including our former co-host Sean Coyle and of course Joe Blow, editor in chief Paul Shirey, were going to see it, and you had not seen it, so I was like, well, hey, shit, I'll watch it again.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I went, and then I watched it another time the next week, and I think all told, I saw it definitely three times and possibly four times in the theater.
Oh, wow. So during that time span, were you feeling the diminishing?
I did, in the sense that, you know, the thematically and tonally, it didn't stay with me beyond just being sort of inexperienced. And I think if there's anything you can say about the original Planet of the Apes is that it finds a way, in a narrative sense, to really kind of get under your skin, and it leaves you pondering it. Mm-hmm. For a long time. And I mean, I'm sure I can even speak for you on that score, that the original film has imagery and a tone and whatnot that does do the job of really sticking with you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Ralph Winter, by the way, real quick, I believe Ralph Winter, you know, he produced this film, and he came and gave a talk to you at Biola University, right?
Yeah. He was a pretty actively involved producer who would come and talk to us students, and he also was involved with the X-Men franchise.
That's right.
for a stretch
and,
there.
And the Star Trek films.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Nice guy. Very nice guy.
So, okay. So here we go.
Well, and then, I mean, it's worth just pointing out, as long as this is a commentary, being a Tim Burton film, we have our opening credits where we get to see sort of a series of images that tease the film we're about to watch.
That's
right?
Kind of a Burton thing, right?
Yeah, he does that for even all. I just saw Miss Peregrine, I had mentioned on our show, which I liked and I recommend, by the way, if you're a fan of Tim Burton. And it, same thing. I was wondering when I started it if he still was doing that. And yep, that's almost like an overture for his movies.
And
visual overture.
You know, there will be plenty of time to talk about the negatives of this film, but, you know, we were just talking through the Danny Elfman opening track, and I think Elfman's score is one of the good aspects of this film.
Mm-hmm.
It's very different from what Jerry Goldsmith did with the original Apes in 68, but I think it's one of the last truly memorable Elfman scores that I can think of off the top of my head.
I think that's true, because obviously for us it would be, I think 89 was when we first noticed him with Batman. I mean, Beetlejuice and Pee-wee's Big Adventure before that, of course. But then he just started sounding very samey.
Yeah.
And not even samey to himself, but just to what scores were doing in general. And you could hear a score and see it's Danny Elfman and not even know it was him, which was kind of a bummer.
Yes.
But this one, yeah, I remember this one. I have it on silent, obviously, right now, but I can hear it in my head.
Now, Mark Wahlberg here, he plays Captain Leo Davidson, and he might as well be Cade Yeager.
for Transformers series.
For as distinctive as the character is. Now, kind of interesting, when the production was ramping up, all they knew was they wanted kind of a young beefcake looking guy. And so they had actually first offered it to Matt Damon.
Huh.
And Matt Damon turned it down because it was between this and The Bourne Identity.
Oh, wow.
So Damon went off to make The Bourne Identity, which, of course, historically has proven to be the right choice.
Mm-hmm.
And Mark Wahlberg had not read the script, but for him, the selling point was, oh, Tim Burton. I'll do it because of Tim Burton. And Mark Wahlberg, it's, you know, now we think of Mark Wahlberg as a much more established actor, but at the time, really, he had done, in terms of sort of quote-unquote prestige pictures, he had done Boogie Nights, of course, and Three Kings.
Mm, right.
You know, I mean, before that, he did Fear. Remember that movie with Reese Witherspoon? So he was not sort of quote-unquote serious actor Mark Wahlberg as he is now.
Right. Even more so remembered as Marky Mark than he is right now.
That's right. Although I remember watching this opening night and Mark Wahlberg's credit came up and people started cheering in the theater. So,
oh, really? He had already made an impact.
He was clearly a draw to like the teenage girl set.
I saw also looking in trivia and whatnot that he turned down doing Ocean's 11. Playing, well, I think, the Matt Damon character, actually. Linus.
Those two were kind of ships in the night for a little. That makes sense, actually, because if you remember, he had already done The Perfect Storm and Three Kings with with George Clooney.
Mm.
So it stands to reason that the Matt Damon role probably would have gone to Wahlberg had he chosen to do it.
Yeah.
So also a bad choice. And we're going to see a couple examples of sort of historically poor choices between this movie and something else, which we'll talk about as it gets a little closer.
Is that ship a model?
It is indeed a model, yeah.
Looks like a model.
You can definitely tell. Now this is the quote-unquote present-day portion of this is actually about 50 years in the future. This portion here. And I think...
The future, Conan?
That's right. That's definitely a model, Brian.
Yeah, it looks good.
Now, this is the space station Oberon, and that's going to become a plot point later on, so we'll pay attention to that.
Oh, there's that... I can't remember his name, that character actor. He's in a lot of Michael Bay movies.
Yeah, he's like military guy.
You're out of line, sir.
Yeah.
I saw him at a restaurant. I've seen him a couple times, actually, at restaurants in Burbank. I'm always like, it's that guy.
Yeah, it's he's like Glenn Morshower, you know, that other guy who...
Yep. Aaron Pierce from 24. And
yeah, that's right. So
well, now, this whole opening, right? So is any of this based on the book?
No, it's not. And that actor's name is Chris Ellis, by the way, the commander of the Oberon. He plays Commander Vasek. This is kind of its own thing. And the script, by the way, is by William Broyles, who wrote Apollo 13.
Oh. Huh.
So I think the studio was like, hey, he knows how to write spacemen in peril.
Right.
You know, but again, worth remembering that this project, as it exists in this current form, was the tail end of about 14 years of development hell.
Hmm.
So very, very lengthy and very circuitous and through a variety of different iterations before they ended up here. In terms of the approach this film takes to the subject matter, it has basically nothing to do with the book, and honestly, it has basically nothing to do with the original film.
Right.
So Tim Burton said right up top, it's not going to be a remake, it's not going to be a sequel, it's going to be a quote-unquote reimagining.
Okay.
Which, to me, is one of those terms that's like corporate nonsense, which means nothing, you know?
Right.
It's a truly nothing buzzword, and I don't know what it really says. I do think that this is one of those examples of just a complete mismatch between subject matter and filmmaker. I think that Tim Burton was just the wrong guy to make this movie in the sense that, I mean, when you watch this, there's nothing explicitly Burton about it, you know?
Yeah, surprisingly so.
And I think that he felt constrained by the requirements of working within this sort of franchise framework. And I also think that what he brought to it wasn't particularly enervating or, you know, it didn't really add anything.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, I read interviews that were contemporaneous at the time where he, you know, his concept of the Apes universe as defined by the original films was just off. And I'll point out some examples of that as we go through, but I think that's reflected. So I think Fox was sort of looking at it like, hey, we've got this marquee filmmaker and this very well-known IP. What could go wrong? That was their thought process.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see why the studio went there, but I just think it was a mismatch.
Which is interesting because as we were just going over Batman 89, I did like a deep dive in behind the scenes stuff. And it's just fascinating that similar story, they wanted to get – it took a long, long time to develop that movie and get it to the screen. And it's funny that they went with for wanting to get live-action Batman in a very serious way on the big screen, it's interesting that they chose such a stylistically specific person.
Right.
Right. I mean, you were getting, you weren't just getting a Batman movie. You were getting a Tim Burton Batman movie.
Yes.
And for all that work and all that time, obviously it worked out and it's one of my favorite movies. So, but it's just interesting then with Planet of the Apes, I wonder who else they had in mind and then why they thought, like, let's do the Tim Burton version of this. Or I guess you could say at this time by now, Tim Burton was Tim Burton. He's a household name. And they thought that that was what would get people excited.
And that's essentially where it was. I mean, he was obviously the guy who made Batman, but I mean, he had just made Sleepy Hollow shortly before this, which was a pretty substantial hit.
Yeah.
And, you know, so in terms of marquee directors, we're talking mid to late 90s. I mean, Tim Burton was up or near the top of the list.
Right.
I think his visibility has fallen to some extent in the, you know, decade and change since. But at the time, absolutely.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. But it is interesting, as you said, that this doesn't necessarily feel like a Tim Burton film.
It really doesn't. I mean, even when we get to the ape planet, other than a few touches here and there, he's relatively restrained. And I honestly think that connotes a certain lack of interest on his part.
Hmm.
Maybe not like, oh, I'm so bored with doing this, but I, on an emotional level, I don't think he plugged in.
Mm-hmm.
And to be clear, I don't even necessarily want to see the plugged in Tim Burton version of Apes, because I think just fundamentally he's the wrong guy to be making this movie.
Yeah, I think that's what I was trying to sort of say earlier. Like, when you get his Batman, you get his huge gothic, absurdly tall buildings and whatnot.
And by the way, Brian, I mean, look at his Batman, right? Really, Batman Returns is his Batman.
Yes. Oh, yeah, for sure.
And that
sure.
was the one where the studio was like, you know, I think we're good.
Yeah, yeah.
So
I remember being excited at the prospect of this specifically as a Burton film.
Yeah.
But I don't know what that would even look like. You know, more spirals in Ape City or, you know, I don't know.
That's true.
Maybe that's it, too. I mean, he's a little limited by his natural setting. I don't know.
I don't think he's a storyteller. I think he's a scenarist, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Now, by the way, so we're going through the time warp here, and I think it's if we're doing a comparison, a 1-to-1 comparison between the 68 one and this one, I mean, it's going to be, I've said this before, some variation of this about other films, where if you've already gotten the best version of a movie, then any other take on it is by definition going to be the less good version.
Right? Yeah.
And, you know, I said that about Ghostbusters and last year, and I think the same thing applies certainly for Planet of the Apes. I mean, I think that particular story, the astronaut who ends up on a Planet of Apes, well, that's, we've already gotten the prototypical version of that.
Mm-hmm.
So now everything that they do has to either evoke that or contrast with that. And those are both bad options.
Mm-hmm.
So here we're you know, about 15 minutes into the movie, and Leo here, he crashes on the planet, and basically he gets out of his ship, and then the hunt sequence starts.
Mm-hmm.
Like right away. And, you know, when you contrast that with the original film, where the a good half hour is these astronauts walking across the desert.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe modern audiences think that's too luxurious, or it's taken too long. I think that's crucial because it's setting a sense of tone and desolation and desperation that's really important for everything that comes after, right? And so this film, right, it gives you a sense of how it set its sights much lower, because it's not really interested in kind of a visceral unease. It just wants a summer action experience.
Right.
And the problem with that is, well, that if that's what you're making, that's what you're going to get. And there's a reason that, 16 years later, nobody talks about this movie.
It's kind of funny. It looks like Mark Wahlberg's on Dagobah here.
Yeah. That's the other thing, by the way. This film is almost entirely stage bound. And it shows.
Right.
You know, now we're about to bump into Chris Christopherson, who's in this movie for some inexplicable reason.
Yeah, two things I wanted to point out. So we don't have any crewmates with him.
That's
it's
right.
A solo experience as opposed to the original here. And then also, when he was in the planet's atmosphere, we saw that it was not Earth.
That's right. So they do have makeup on this planet, however, as we can see from Estella Warren there. Chris Christopherson, there was Karubi, and Dana is the name of Estella Warren's character. Estella Warren, by the way, who has had basically no career after this movie.
Yeah, she was...
She was like the hot young thing for about 6 months between January of 2001 and August of 2001.
It was funny, actually, when I rewatched this, seeing her, I was like, oh, yeah. It kind of reminded me of a time and place.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is the hunt sequence. Now, contrast this with the hunt sequence in the original film, right? Now, this goes to, I think, Tim Burton's fundamental misreading of the subject matter. He says, you know, I watched the original Apes movie, and one thing I didn't like is they weren't enough like apes.
And during that sequence in particular, or the whole movie?
In the whole film. He's like, they were too human, right? And so one of his marching orders for this film was to have the apes act more ape-like. And I think that weakens the story, because the what makes the hunt sequence so creepy still is that the apes are not acting like apes.
Right. They're very human-like.
They're riding horses, and they're not screaming and shrieking and whatnot. They're very methodical in the way that they're hunting the humans. So... Right here, right off the top. Again, we're about less than 20 minutes into the movie. You're like, okay, Tim Burton doesn't get it. You know. Now, that being said, I said I'd point out the good stuff. I mean, these ape makeups by Rick Baker are phenomenal.
Yeah.
I mean, they really are. And it's kind of funny, because over the long development cycle for this film, it kind of went back and forth whether Rick Baker or Stan Winston were going to do the effects. You know, great Stan Winston. So you can imagine either, you know, the Stan Winston version would have been just as good.
I was going to say, I mean, yeah, embarrassment of riches there.
Yeah, exactly. Now Rick Baker was kind of like the guy when it came to apes, because he did the Kong mask for the 1976 remake of King Kong. He also plays King Kong in that film. He's the guy in the suit.
Oh.
If you ever watched that movie. And he was kind of unhappy with how that experience turned out, even though the ape costume turned out pretty good. So he worked on Greystoke in 1982, I believe.
That's a
Tarzan movie with Christopher Lambert. And then a few years later, he did Gorillas in the Mist with Sigourney Weaver.
Wow. So he just kept trying to...
Yeah. And Gorillas in the Mist was kind of extraordinary, because his special effects ape costumes were mixed in with regular gorillas.
Oh, wow.
And I mean, I defy you to see who's real and who's not, you know? Hmm. So doing the ape makeups for this was something that he, as a fan, really wanted to do. And I think, you know, in terms of use of practical effects, this shows how effective the current series could have been had they chosen to go that route. Obviously, this is almost like the last gasp for practical effects, because we've moved so far in the direction of motion capture.
Yeah, and I, as they just showed...
Real quick, by the way, the woman next to Mark Wahlberg there...
Oh, yeah.
That's Linda Harrison. She is Nova in the original Apes and the sequel. So she was the ex-wife of Richard Zanuck, who at the time of the 1968 movie, he was the head of Fox, and he greenlit the movie. So he's kind of the reason Apes got made. And that's Rick Baker right there, by the way, on the right.
Oh, funny.
Richard Zanuck produced this film. He was the producer. Mm-hmm. You know, between the time he left Fox in the early 70s and this, he'd become a very well-known producer. He did Jaws, of course, the original Jaws. He also did Deep Impact. I mean, he had built up a very solid reputation as a producer. So yeah, there's Linda Harrison right there. So they came to him to produce this. And so as he said at the time, he was in his own little time warp.
Yeah. But I'm like really taken with the, production design, and when they showed the exterior of the city as the cart was pulling up, I mean, it looks amazing.
It looks amazing, but it also looks very stagey.
This does.
Yes.
Inside. I'm sort of impressed with some of the visual effects that I now would have this sort of, I'm not saying better or worse, but it would just look like they look now, but for being an older effect and being more practical, they still look pretty good.
Yeah.
I do agree with you, though. This village here looks like a stage.
It's very stagey, and I think to its detriment, to the film's detriment. I mean, it feels very claustrophobic. And that's Helena Bonham Carter as Ari. Now, Tim Burton was at the time engaged to Lisa Marie, who is in this film, but he met Helena Bonham Carter on this film, and he ditched his fiance for her. So I wonder if it was because of the ape makeup.
I was going to say, that's kind of interesting if this is where love struck, because she was under all that makeup all this time.
we learned something about Tim Burton.
Yeah.
And there's Paul Giamatti. But I mean, you can't undervalue the cast that they put together for this film. Very much like the original one, where they went to real actors.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you look at the cast roster for this. I mean, certainly at the time, Wahlberg was the odd man out in terms of having credibility of a long established career. I mean, Wahlberg was kind of on the rise at the time, but he wasn't respected in the same way that he is now, you know?
Right.
I think, and that was one of the things that Wahlberg, by the way, was like, I'm not wearing a loincloth. And that was because he was known at the time for being an underwear model.
Right. Right.
So he didn't want to bring those, comparisons back.
Who were some of the other directors they were looking at? Do you know?
Okay, so so far as the development process goes, this started in 1988, the development process. Mm-hmm. And actually, even before that, now that I think about it, because J. Lee Thompson, who directed the fourth and fifth Apes movies in the original cycle, and J. Lee Thompson also did the original Cape Fear, he did The Guns of Navarone, so he was a pretty well-respected director at the time. So he was doing movies for Canon in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so he went to Canon, and he was like, you know, you guys should go to Fox and see if you can get them to sell you the Apes rights. This is like early 80s, early to mid 80s. And at the time, Fox was like, no, we're, you know, they still saw it as a valuable IP, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so they hung on to it. In 1988, a director named Adam Rifkin, who did, what would you know? He did The Chase with Charlie Sheen.
I remember that, yeah.
He also did Detroit Rock City.
Okay.
About 10 years after. So about 88, he had just done his first film, which I can't remember the title off the top of my head, but his first film was called Never on Tuesday.
Okay.
So he goes, so Fox invites him in to pitch ideas, and he was a huge, huge Apes fan. So he says, if you guys give me the chance to do an Apes movie, I can do it for you at a low budget. I'm an independent filmmaker, and it'll be amazing. And he kind of was like, I could do like Aliens for you guys.
Hmm.
Right, because Aliens is another Fox film, and that was a pretty low budget, and it was, you know, a sequel to a very well-respected film at the time. Mm-hmm. And so that's when the idea of a new Apes movie actually started, was 88. However, you know, the idea that he had got pretty far along, and his idea, by the way, was not a reboot, and it was not a sequel. It was an alternate sequel to the first movie. So he would ignore the other sequels and just do a follow-up to the 68 movie.
So like a Superman Returns.
Kind of, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And so that actually got pretty far along. And then there was a change at the studio, and so they killed his idea. But which is like, it happens all the time, right?
I was going to say, it's like such a common story. It was such a bummer for very, very many creative people over the years.
Throughout the years. That was far enough along where Rick Baker, again, had been already hired to do the makeups.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, the movie was going to be called Return to the Planet of the Apes, and they were looking, it would have followed the son or grandson of Charlton Heston's character. And they were thinking of like a Tom Cruise or a Charlie Sheen type for that.
Mm-hmm.
And so that gets killed. But the idea of doing a new Planet of the Apes does not. It's just that particular idea goes away.
Yeah.
So then they went to Peter Jackson.
Hmm.
right? So this is like early 90s. So he's, at the time, he was another low-budget filmmaker. I mean, what was he known for at that time?
Like horror creature feature stuff.
Yeah, exactly, right? So him and Fran Walsh, they had an idea where it would be like the apes civilization is going through kind of a renaissance period. And then there's this conflict between expanding knowledge versus holding knowledge in. And Peter Jackson even wanted Roddy McDowall to be in it in some capacity, because Roddy McDowall at the time was like synonymous with the Apes films.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea of doing another Apes without having Roddy McDowall, especially if you're Peter Jackson, you can imagine was probably a big fan.
Fanboy, right? Yeah.
So that was his idea. That didn't happen. 1993... Oliver Stone comes on board.
Nah, what?
Yeah. This is, you know, I used this metaphor before, but it's so applicable. This is like the scene in Airplane where the people are just lining up to smack. It's just one after the other, really. So Oliver Stone's idea, totally different. His idea is that, this is crazy. Yeah, it was, there's basically babies are being born, stillborn.
Okay.
So no new babies are being born.
And like
so,
children of men.
It's kind of like that, yeah. And so it's like, oh my gosh, the civilization is going to die. And so what do the scientists find out that there's like a genetic, basically a genetic time bomb that has been planted in human beings going back millions and millions of years. So somehow a scientist travels back in time to Earth in the distant, distant past, and that's where Earth is a planet of apes.
Oh, okay.
So it's not the far future, it's not another planet. It's in the distant past.
Interesting. So sort of an evolution story? But they would have to be evolved to the point of human-like.
Yeah. So there is, in essence, there's a moment in the past where apes are hyper-intelligent, and this is the moment where humans become the dominant species.
Hmm.
So I don't know if that would have been interesting. It would have been different, obviously.
It would have been different. Yeah.
and so Oliver Stone brought in Terry Hayes to write that. Terry Hayes wrote the three Mad Max films.
Mm-hmm.
And Arnold Schwarzenegger was attached to that.
Really?
Yeah. To play the scientist. Because, of course, when you think scientist, you think Arnold Schwarzenegger, right? So, and it's funny because I remember at the time, 1993, because bear in mind, I'm a fan, right? So I'm following these developments as they are occurring.
Mm-hmm.
Pre-internet, but as close to real time as possible.
Wait, can you just, I don't even want to deviate, but how does that work? Like through like Starlog or something?
Through Starlog, through magazines, through whatever I could find.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, okay. I mean, this is before internet, you know?
Yeah.
So I was making it my business to keep up with what was going on. And I mean, there were plenty of times throughout this process where I was like, oh, they're probably in production right now. And of course they weren't.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there's David Warner, by the way, on the screen as we're watching, as Ari's father. A lot of actors in this, actually. There's Eric Avari in the back as the servant.
Hmm.
Kind of, and we're going to see the party sequence in just a bit, where a couple other Tim Burton regulars. But so the Oliver Stone version, that goes away. Schwarzenegger's still attached. He wants Philip Noyce to do it. You know, Philip Noyce, right, from Clear and Present Danger.
Mm-hmm.
And he was attached for a little while. Then he left. There's Lisa Marie, by the way, right there.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's Glenn Shaddix from Beetlejuice.
Right, right.
Left. And he's passed away since then.
And they really shine through that makeup, their personalities, and
that's the thing. I mean, the makeup effects are, say what you will about the movie, the makeup effects are phenomenal.
Yeah, like it really allows the actors to act through. They're not like, just the nuances of their personalities and faces are really coming through that makeup.
Yeah.
Anyway,
so the production process continues. So now we're into the mid-90s. Oliver Stone is gone. Philip Noyce is on board. Philip Noyce leaves. Chris Columbus comes on.
I could see that.
Yeah, Arnold Schwarzenegger still attached.
Ah.
Chris Columbus brings on Sam Hamm, who wrote Batman with Tim Burton. Mm-hmm. And that version, it just scraps everything else, and that's another planet. The ape planet is another planet. And then some scientists go there, they come home, and the time they come back, it's become a planet of apes, just like in the book.
Mm-hmm.
So by this point, Rick Baker is gone. Stan Winston is on. And Stan Winston and Rick Baker basically just take turns through this whole process, right?
Yeah. Because they got to take other work.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you can't just be waiting around. So Schwarzenegger's still attached. Columbus drops out. At that point, they go to Roland Emmerich.
These are names that completely make sense, especially at this time,
at
right?
At this time, right? So Roland Emmerich, before Independence Day comes out, they go to him. He's still doing Independence Day. Independence Day becomes a big hit. At that point, Roland Emmerich drops out.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Roland Emmerich drops out, so then they go to James Cameron.
Oh, wow.
So James Cameron is obviously, he was doing Titanic at the time, so he would have just produced this.
Okay.
But he
which would up, be interesting.
Which would have absolutely been interesting. And he was attached for a while, and I have to imagine that Schwarzenegger was the guy who kind of got him. That kind of makes sense, Cameron doing Apes, because he had an overall deal, I think he still does, with 20th Century Fox. It's a Fox property.
You saying that makes me think we don't see enough James Cameron produce stuff.
That's true.
I would like to see him shepherd some things and find exciting filmmakers to do those things. And
yeah, I mean, that's very true. I mean, we get floated potential ideas for Cameron produced movies that never really happen. So Cameron, he's involved for a while and he's shaping the story. And then after Titanic comes out, he drops out. Fox goes to Michael Bay. He considers
really?
It. Yeah, Michael Bay was there. He was considered it. He said he wanted to do it.
Uh-huh.
But he dropped out.
And this would be not long after The Rock, so he would be...
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
So
yeah.
He was on the rise. This is before Armageddon.
Mm-hmm.
But he decides not to do it. Then they go back to Peter Jackson, who there was like a period there where the Lord of the Rings movies, it might have gotten canceled.
Mm-hmm.
So before Lord of the Rings starts production, they go to Peter Jackson. And this is right around the time that Roddy McDowall passes away, which is like fall of 98.
Mm.
Peter Jackson's like, I'm not doing it without him.
Oh, wow.
So he doesn't do it. And then they went to the Hughes brothers.
Okay.
Who did From Hell.
Yep.
So by now we're like 99-2000. So then Bill Broyles submits his script for this. And it's kind of interesting because his idea was something much more expansive, right? He thought of this as the first episode in the Chronicles of Ashlar, which is the name of this planet, which they never actually say in the movie, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And that script was what got Fox's attention, and then Fox sent it to Burton, that's when he signed on. And early 2000, he signed on.
That's interesting that – is this script pretty close to what was there before Burton came on?
I would imagine that the version that we got they put it through the Burtonatron 2000.
That's what I was wondering because, again, with all this Batman stuff I had been watching, they had some sort of basis. But, yeah, I got – Burtonized, right? It should. I mean, when the director comes on, they put their stamp on it. But I thought you were about to say that this was the thing they wanted to make. Then they got Burton to make it. And then it would just further support what you were saying, where maybe he wasn't very passionate about it. This looks good.
he brought in Conrad Rosenthal, right? Lawrence Conrad and Mark Rosenthal, who also wrote Superman 4, by the way.
Ah.
And so they did some rewrites. Now, Bill Broyles says that the rewrites... didn't significantly alter his story idea. So I don't think this is a situation where you have two scripts that are sort of pulling against each other. I think that it's this weird situation where I think you have a studio that's looking at an IP that's very well known, but they're not looking at why the IP is well known.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really reflective of what we see here, which is this fascinating world. Like, I mean, if you were to call this anything but Planet of the Apes, I think you could agree that it's very well visualized.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think the problem is that when you take ownership of that title, you have a certain responsibility to it above just, oh, look, there's apes. You know, I think there's thematically,
right?
Because the Apes series is about something. It's not just about, oh, look, it's a Planet of Apes. That's not the thesis.
Right, Right.
You know, the thesis is about human beings and how we treat each other and our potential to do real harm to each other. And I think this film really skates past that. And I think part of it is because the protagonist is fundamentally an uninteresting protagonist.
Mm-hmm.
He's reactive.
Which is interesting because a lot of people would say that about Batman.
Sure.
In the Burton films.
And what we know about those films is that he clearly had much more interest in the villains.
Uh-huh.
You know, and sort of, you know, the Batman Returns is basically the Penguin featuring Batman.
Right.
The Penguin and Catwoman featuring Batman, you know?
Right.
And that's the problem. I mean, I think clearly he's got a lot of interest in these ape characters. That's, by the way, that's the Krull, this ape here. That's Cary Hiroyuki Tagawa, who he's Shang Tsung in Mortal Kombat.
Oh,
he's in. He's been
Mortal
in
Kombat.
That's right. I think the problem with the Leo character is that he's never not on top of things.
Hmm.
He's always the guy with the plan.
That's interesting because I'm recalling these particular scenes that are somewhat analog to the original, and there's a real sense of helplessness and like, well, what now?
Yeah.
Exactly. That runs through that film.
Yeah.
A stranger in a strange land, and you just, and he does not have the upper hand a lot of the times, and it feels helpless, and that's what makes it sort of thrilling.
That, yeah. And I mean, really, what the original film does so well, I mean, there's the scene where he's being chased, where Charlton Heston is being chased through the city. And, you know, he goes through the museum and whatnot, and we kind of get this tour of the city. But it culminates in him sort of in the square, and he's being pelted with fruits and rocks and whatnot, and he gets hoisted into the net. And that's a great sequence because it just, as an audience, you're like, where do you go? What do you do?
Mm-hmm.
And you should feel that helplessness because the film starts with him, with Heston's character, on this very high moral dudgeon where he's like, you know, human beings are terrible and blah, 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 right? And so we need to drag the character through the dirt, literally and also metaphorically.
Mm-hmm.
Here, it's just, you know, he's not a particularly deep character. His motivation is, you know, Charlton Heston's, why did he leave the Earth? I need to find something better than man in the universe. Why did Leo end up here? Oh, my monkey ran away. I need to find him. You know?
You know, and when you're talking about all these different takes on these films, I'm realizing the thing that I respond to most is sort of the stranger in a strange land.
Yeah.
Takes on these things. But at the same time, there's something difficult about when you have the original and it's so iconic and you know the twist already, it's like, how do you reapproach that?
And
it's interesting that the ones that are current, the series that we're currently in, is like, well, you don't. Like, we start from a different angle.
That's exactly right. You find a way to incorporate what makes those films memorable.
Mm-hmm.
But do it in a way where you're looking at it from this perspective rather than this perspective.
Yeah, yeah, like, you know this, so now we'll show you another angle of it.
Yeah, so this sequence right here, if, again, you point to analogs, I mean, this is the analog of Taylor's sort of running through the Ape City, because here's Mark Wahlberg, he's going through, like, the Bremen Town Musicians, where he's picking up these different characters, and they go traipsing through the city, and we get little vignettes about what life is like in Ape City. But what is it... what is it doing other than, you know, moving our characters from point A to point B? We're not gaining anything.
Mm-hmm.
Another flaw, obviously, is when you have humans who are here, basically a servile class, but we don't know why. It lessens the immediacy of the threat.
Hmm.
Because when you look at it, like, what's Taylor's concern in the first film? Well, he's like 2 seconds away from being either emasculated or lobotomized.
Right.
Well, that's pretty friggin' terrifying.
Right.
Right. But here there's the reason for why apes are subjugated. There isn't any reason. Not really.
Yeah.
You know? And here we go. There's the Lisa Marie doing her weird sexy dance.
It's just funny, the teenagers out there.
Yeah.
One of my, like, it's funny because they have human-like dress, but it's not very modern. But there was one out there that had, like, a headband and a leather coat on.
Which goes to, I mean, that's definitely something. See this, like, that drives me crazy.
They
jump up and hang on to the chandelier and stuff. I mean, it's cartoonish, you know?
Yeah, right.
Now, granted, I mean, the original film, there's the scene where they're doing, like, the see no evil, hear no evil thing.
Mm-hmm.
But that's like the one moment in the film that really calls attention to its own artificiality.
Yeah.
I don't think we see that here. I think Richard Zanuck, who's the producer of the film, he gave an interview back in 1998 when the big 30th anniversary celebration of the original Apes was happening, this documentary. And, you know, all the filmmakers who were alive at the time have since passed away, but they were talking about making the film, and they were like, you know, we were making a social commentary. We were trying to say something about race relations and about nuclear war and about all these things that were pressing. And then they go to Richard Zanuck, this is before he produces the new film, but, you know, he's in hindsight looking at his involvement in the original films. And he says, you know, we weren't trying to make anything. we weren't trying to make a statement. We were just trying to make an adventure movie. And you know, people have read a bunch of stuff into it, but that was never the plan, right? And I'm like, well, obviously that's not true because the filmmakers themselves have said that. You know,
right.
You're telling me Rod Serling doesn't have some social...
I was just going to say that.
Right?
Yeah.
And so when he signed on to produce Apes 2001, that was my first, like, my Spidey sense.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure he was a lovely man, but I was like, it's going to be surface level.
Mm-hmm.
And I, to be honest, I think Tim Burton too. I mean, I don't know that Tim Burton, I don't know that he has a worldview that necessarily speaks to what those films were about.
Yeah, that's interesting because he is the sort of freak outsider.
Yeah.
Is the typical protagonist in his films.
Yeah, exactly.
Which I guess is, I mean, he could have leaned more into that where someone who you would assume is quote unquote normal is the outsider now in an entire planet. But that isn't really what this movie's about.
Yeah. And I think that's the fundamental disconnect is Fox had a situation where, you know, the original Apes was an accidental franchise.
Right.
They had no intention of it being, spawning a sequel, much less four sequels, much less TV show and cartoon, much less toys and everything else. That all happened organically.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas with this one, it was 1998's Godzilla. You know, remember that? Where that was like...
Oh, yeah.
It was prefabricated. Oh, we got the action figures, we got the Happy Meal toys, we got the whole thing. That was this. I mean, they had the toys were on shelves 2 months before the movie even came out.
See, that's why I don't even remember that. And even watching this now, this doesn't feel like an action figure movie to me.
Yeah. And that tells you something, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think if you want to look at the current series as a contrast, I mean, that tells you everything that that's a franchise that really has managed to sort of float just under the radar.
You're making me think right now that I actually want a Cade Yeager action figure. I think that's something I want.
I don't think you do, Brian. A Leo Davidson action figure. Yeah, I mean, so Chris Gustafsson here is about to exit the film. The question is, why did he enter the film? Because he's completely... I mean, it could have been anybody. I could have played his character, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, he's fine. It is kind of a specific choice.
I mean, I don't know that he adds any degree of, like, extra credibility. Not because Chris Gustafsson is not a credible actor, but his character is so completely extraneous.
Mm-hmm. He's got quite a majestic mane. I'll give him that.
But he's not in here like Alec Guinness, you know?
No.
You know? Now, this is, by the way, we should mention that that's Michael Clarke Duncan as Attar, the late Michael Clarke Duncan. And, I mean, you can see his face right through that appliance.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty extraordinary.
He was behind me in line at a grocery store once.
Really?
Yeah, several years ago, and he's a tall man.
I've heard he was just a teddy bear.
Yeah, I've heard that too.
Yeah, it's such a shame.
Yeah.
Now, Tim Roth here is fantastic in this movie. I mean, he's chewing the scenery with absolute gusto. His character arc doesn't make a lot of sense. And this again is a distinction from the other films where you had a clear delineation between the different ape species. So the chimpanzees were the pacifists and the intellectuals, the gorillas are sort of the blue collar in the military, and then the orangutans were the elites. Here it's much more mixed in, and that was because Tim Burton said, yeah, well, chimpanzees are scary. Which they are. Chimpanzees are legit scary. That's true. But I think the racial demarcations are again something that's intrinsic to the stories.
Right.
Now we were talking about actors being given different choices. So Tim Roth was actually the second choice because they had first offered the role of General Thade to Gary Oldman.
I can see that, sure. Yeah,
absolutely. And Gary Oldman, of course, would return to the franchise.
Yeah.
So he got a second bite with Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, which I think he lucked out because he didn't have to wear the ape appliances.
Yeah, right.
But he wanted more money than they were willing to pay, so then they went to Tim Roth, who at the time was best known for Pulp Fiction, and he'd also been in Rob Roy. He was great. This is basically the ape version of his Rob Roy character.
Oh, who, I've never seen Rob Roy.
Oh, you should watch Rob Roy. It's really good.
Yeah.
That's one of those, like, because it came out around the same time as Braveheart.
Uh-huh. That's how I remember it. Like, another Braveheart.
Yeah. Even though it's Irish and it's the forgotten kilt movie, basically.
Yeah.
But Tim Roth had, so he was offered Planet of the Apes, and he was also offered Severus Snape in the Harry Potter movies.
Oh, man.
So we talk about good choices, bad choices. He made the bad choice.
Yeah. Man, can you imagine?
What a different
Is that universe. When the first Harry Potter came out, 2001?
2001, yeah.
All right,
just
yeah.
2 months after this.
Oh, wow.
So, but I mean, as much as I love Tim Roth, can you imagine anybody but Alan Rickman as Snape?
I know.
Like, it's, you know, that's so distinctive.
And that's funny, too. You mentioned Chris Columbus because after him having to do possibly doing this film, he must have shortly gone on then to develop Harry Potter.
Yeah, exactly, because the first Potter film started development in probably 99 or so, very shortly after the first book came out. So this drives me crazy. I mean, the fact that it is so stage-bound just feels very claustrophobic.
Yeah. I have to throw this out here. This is not related to anything, but I'm looking at this set again. It reminds me of Dagobah.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised Weird Al never did a parody version of Van Halen's Panama as Dagobah.
Dagobah. Well, he did Yoda, Dagobah. So maybe. Maybe he was just saying, like, I've gone to that well once already.
I'm just throwing it out there. If Weird Al happens to be listening, that one's free.
Al,
I want to hear it personally.
We know you listen to our commentary tracks.
Yeah, right. We're big fans. And then the rest of this commentary is just us saying hi to Weird Al.
Yeah. Remember that time we went to the Weird Al concert?
Yeah.
That was a lot of fun. That was a year ago.
Oh, wow. Ugh. Dead apes.
So yeah, those are the apes that General Thade killed.
Mm-hmm.
Because the role of General Thade in this film is very similar to Dr. Zaius in the original film.
Right.
In that he's the ape with the knowledge of the planet's hidden history. What is the hidden history? This goes to the distinction. I mean, the in the original film, it's, you know, mankind destroyed the Earth.
Mm-hmm.
That's a heavy burden to bear. Here, it's like, well, you know, man crashed on this planet long ago.
Because is that – I'm not remembering it very well, but – they accidentally kickstarted this planet, right?
Yeah. So,
in this version,
we'll get to it later, but basically, when Leo goes through his time warp, the Oberon in searching for him gets pulled through and crashes on this planet many, many, many years ago in the past. So the humans here are descendants of the Oberon crew, and the apes are descendants of the captive apes.
Right.
But the Oberon is in the past, and Leo is in the future. Does that make sense? Am I?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's actually the fact that I'm having to, like, do this whole trying to map out. That's another problem in this film, is it lacks the simplicity, the simple elegance of what happens in the original film, mm-hmm. which I don't need to get into at this point, but I mean, everybody knows it. On this actor, by the way, he was in Land of the Dead. That's what I know him from. There's a zombie called Big Daddy who like ends up being the leader of the zombies, and that's that African American actor. This is Paul Giamatti. He had not been nominated for an Oscar yet, I don't think.
Sideways must have been very shortly after this, right?
Sideways,
like really early 2000s.
I think it was 2003.
Okay.
I want to say so. It was before, but he was pretty well known as a character actor at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no disguising his voice, Paul.
No. I mean, he has a very large style.
Yeah.
And it definitely suits this character here.
See, so
he's right, memorable, right?
He's memorable. I think even in this, yeah. And you know, before this, he had done The Negotiator. He was good in that, and Private Parts, which he was fantastic in.
Oh, right, right.
Have you seen Private Parts?
Yeah. The Howard Stern.
For a brief moment, they were talking about Howard Stern getting nominated for an Oscar.
Yeah, yeah. I kind of forgot about that.
Cooler heads prevailed.
Oh, I read somewhere also that they had talked about not giving the apes eyebrows. And then it looked disconcerting, so now all the apes have eyebrows. Was that a thing?
I believe it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think you have to figure out how to make the appliances human enough that you can relate to them as characters.
Right. And emote. They have to emote.
Yeah. And I mean, I have to imagine that Rick Baker would be the first to say that John Chambers paved the way for this. You know, John Chambers, who did the original ape effect. But I mean, it really is extraordinary. I mean, the appliances in service of a better film would have been extraordinary, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I would have loved to see them do something in the vein of those original movies with the same costume designs and whatnot, but with these modern makeup effects.
Right. Right.
Now, they have a love triangle in this film between Ari, the Helena Bonham Carter character and Estella Warren. And mm-hmm. that love triangle is really bizarre, but it goes to Tim Burton's peculiar sensibilities. He gave an interview where he was like, I'd love to have like a love scene between the ape woman and Mark Wahlberg.
It's one of those things where I can picture someone being like, why? And yeah. Like, 'cause screw you.
Yeah, 'cause screw like, you. You know, and that's one of those things where you know this. Even the studio is probably like, "Yeah, no, you're not doing that."
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Or even like, I can truly picture him being like, "I don't know, because why not?" You know, like as if I'm going to do this, might as well just try to push it as many ways as I can.
Just go as nuts as possible.
Right. Not because he thought it was a truly great idea.
Right. Well, but again, given that this is where he met Helena Bonham Carter and they had a fruitful relationship, you know, we're getting some fascinating insights into. Yeah. Now, really, I mean, Tim Roth is just dialing it up to 11 here.
Yeah. He's good. He's one of those things that doesn't happen often to me as an adult when I watch a movie where the villain actually feels scary.
Yeah.
You know, when you're like, oh, man, that guy's so unhinged and unpredictable, I am actually afraid of what he might do. Like, if someone comes and approaches him, like, you know, I thought I saw them in the woods. You're like, dude, I don't know if I'd talk to that guy. Like, he might just kill me for looking at him.
And that's certainly a valid way of portraying a chimpanzee, because chimpanzees are friggin' terrifying.
Right.
You know, you hear stories all the time of people who have them as pets, and they're fine one minute, and then they tear people apart.
Yeah.
You know, that's you don't want to mess with that. Now, the ape movement training was done by a guy named Terry Notary in this film, who's known in Hollywood as like he's a former Cirque du Soleil performer. Mm. But he had such a good experience on this that he became sort of the go-to guy for Ape School. So he trained all the actors in doing ape movements. And then for Rise of the Planet of the Apes and its sequels, he is the guy who does the ape training for those actors.
Oh, okay.
In those films, he plays the character Rocket, who is Caesar's right-hand ape.
Oh, wow. So he made like a little side career out of this.
Yeah. And I told this story on our regular show, but at the 2014 Dawn of the Planet of the Apes world premiere, I was at the after party and there was Andy Serkis there. And I was talking to him and I was very excited to talk to him. And then I was like, oh, do you mind if I get a picture? And he was like, oh, sure. And it was very dark, so I was trying to get somebody to take the picture, and then I was like, excuse me, sir, would you mind taking the picture? And it was Terry Notary. And
Did you notice?
Well, I didn't, to be honest, because I didn't know what he looks like. And Andy Serkis is like, oh, that's Terry Notary. You should get him in the picture, too. And then we're trying to find somebody. And I was like, sir, excuse me. And he's like, oh, that's Dylan Clark. He's the producer. You should get him to take the picture. And then unfortunately, it was so dark that we weren't able to get the actual picture. Like, it didn't turn out.
Right.
But I have that story to tell.
That's cool to hear that Andy Serkis is that cool.
He was super cool. He was really nice. This is Charlton Heston right here.
Yeah.
Now, Charlton Heston did not want anything to do with this movie, not because he didn't like the idea of doing it, but he didn't want to wear the makeup. However,
out of some sort of principle or just didn't want to?
He's like, it's a pain in the ass. I don't want to do it.
Yeah.
You know, this is basically his last screen appearance in a role that matters. I think his actual final screen appearance was in Bowling for Columbine, the Michael Moore documentary where Michael Moore kind of went after him. He plays a character named Zaius.
Uh-huh.
And he is, in essence, the Zaius character from the previous film, where he's telling his son about the hidden history of mankind. Now, what's interesting here is that Tim Roth did not want to do the scene with Charlton Heston.
Right, because he was a anti-gun, right?
Tim Roth is very anti-gun, and he, I think the quote is let me see if I can find it actually. Yeah, he says, I was contracted so I couldn't get out of it. I feel very strongly about that monster. I made my feelings clear on set, but got myself in makeup and put my gear on, including rubber hands, so I wouldn't be infected if I touched him. And went
in. Wow.
We did the scene and I promptly left.
Huh.
So that's kind of like, that's rough, you know?
Yeah.
And it's weird because certainly for me, politically, I'm probably far more aligned with Tim Roth, especially as it pertains to the NRA. But I feel like, I don't know, because I love Charlton Heston, the icon.
Yeah.
You know, so I don't know that I've never been able to vilify Charlton Heston, even though I found many of his politics really abhorrent at the end of his life.
Yeah, we talk about that a lot. I mean, you and I, it seems, we're able to sort of separate the characters in the film from the people who play them most of the time.
Yeah, usually. Not always.
This is a fascinating scene, then, knowing that context where it's basically Heston giving Roth a gun.
I know. And that's,
take this, beauty of mine.
Yeah, exactly. You know?
Yeah.
And that's it. Well, and what's funny is that he's the purpose of the gun in this scene is Heston's character being like, this is the reason they kill each other. This is why humans are horrible. So, and he was the president of the NRA at this time. So, you know, I wonder what he thought about that, if anything.
Yeah, that's true. Man, that makeup really holds up to scrutiny in HD here on a big television.
Oh, it really does.
It's amazing. Yeah. You can see right up his nose. Like, it's not even.
But you know what's extraordinary is you look at Thade, the Tim Roth character, and if you were to put it like side by side with a shot of Andy Serkis as Caesar, you wouldn't be able to tell which one is the appliance and which one is the CG.
Oh yeah, huh?
You know, especially in the latest film.
Yeah, I remember the last one in particular. I haven't seen the latest one as of this moment, but. Yeah. Remember, it looked good, but I'm sure by now it looks even better.
I mean, comparing the latest War for the Planet of the Apes with Rise of the Planet of the Apes, you can see the difference in just 6 years. And that's another thing, by the way. You know, I remember at the time this movie came out, Roger Ebert gave a review. And I've said before how Roger Ebert had the ability to write reviews that specific phrases stay with you.
Mm-hmm.
And he said at the time in his review of this, and it was a negative review. He said, it looks great, but it's whatever. He says, in 10 years, when people say they want to watch Planet of the Apes, they're going to be talking about the 68 one.
Right, right, right.
And the truth of that is borne out that literally 10 years after this, there was the reboot film that had nothing to do with this, but was specifically meant to lay the pipe for the original film.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, and that's kind of the... I think, you know, we spend a lot of time on our regular show talking about these franchises that are franchises first and movies a distant third or fourth.
Yeah.
I think this is a good example of that. Where it's, you know, they had their sights set on this sort of multi-platform operation. They didn't first think to make a film that people would actively be compelled to go back to again and again.
Mm-hmm.
I think Bill Broyles, his idea, this Chronicles of Ashlar thing, that says everything, where it was something that sort of backed into being a Planet of the Apes movie.
Right, right.
You know, I think once you set it on another planet, you've distanced it from what it's really about.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fully acknowledging that the book is set on another planet.
Hmm. I was going to say, because when you just said that right now, then that's what makes it different than any other alien movie, right? Where you're crash land on some hostile planet rather than it being something about your history.
I mean, I think what makes the ape films stand apart is that they are an end of the world story where you are being asked to be, you as the audience member are being a party to your own destruction. Does that make sense?
Right. Yeah, no, totally.
Because it's, you know, certainly the most recent films, but even the original series as it progressed, right? You sympathize with the apes as they cast off their human subjugators and take over. So you as the audience are on their side.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of really interesting, you know, thoughts that you have during that. You know, and I over the past week... I've been watching the original Ape series with my kids, and it's been so interesting experiencing them through their eyes.
Hmm.
Because they get it.
Right.
They reflect, they understand. They're like, you know, we watched the third one, which is the two ape scientists from the original film, Cornelius and Zero. They go back in time to the 70s, and they're initially treated well, but eventually human suspicion and whatnot overcomes, and they're murdered, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's the end of the film. They're murdered. I mean, this is a G-rated picture, you know?
Wow.
And my kids get it. They're like, why are they being so mean to them?
Mm-hmm.
They're nice. If they were nice to them, maybe the apes wouldn't take over.
Wow.
That's what my 8-year-old said.
Yeah.
You know? And I was like, that's if you're prompting those kind of thoughts in a child, to me, you're doing it right.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because that's how... you start making a positive difference in the world around you.
Mm-hmm.
I think. Maybe I'm overthinking it.
No. I think that's... because I'm looking at this movie as we're talking through it, and I... like, the movie looks great.
Yeah.
And I don't even think it's, like, outright terrible. It just doesn't have a lot to say, so it doesn't leave much of an impression.
Yeah.
I think that's my probably takeaway of this movie, ultimately. It doesn't demand you to watch it again or to even think about it when it's over, whereas this series has done that in the past, so it feels unremarkable or something.
Yeah. And, I mean, you know, when this movie opened, it was the biggest opening weekend of the year.
Wow.
You know, so that tells... I mean, it dropped like a stone the next week, right? It was a one-week wonder, which at the time... it's funny because we're at a point now where that's every movie almost, you know?
Yeah.
When a movie drops by only 50% these days from one week to the next, we're like, wow.
Right.
It's holding up so well, you know. But the fact that this movie opened as well as it did tells you is that at the time, 2001, there was a large audience that was interested in something being done with this concept.
Yeah, well, and even with the current series running now, I mean, those movies perform well. Like, people are interested in this series.
Yeah, and I mean, I think I I truly think the best thing about the current films is that they perform at a level that justifies their existence, but they don't overperform to the point where the studio gets its mitts in it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? They're all solid hits, but not mega smashes.
Right.
And I think that's good.
To its benefit, yeah.
To its benefit, you know.
And then they don't get overthought.
They really don't. And I think, by the way, Matt Reeves, who did number two and number three of these current films, contrast him with Tim Burton. In that mm-hmm. Matt Reeves is clearly somebody who loves this series.
Right.
And he just, I mean, through his pores, he's able to evoke the exact sort of thematic and tonal response that you should have.
Yeah. Who you've met and spoken with.
Yeah. And man, he talked about it. He talked about growing up. For him, Planet of the Apes was what Star Wars was for other people.
Wow.
You know, he remembers watching it. What he specifically said was he remembers watching Beneath the Planet of the Apes, which is the second one, and seeing the human mutants when they take off their faces and they have these, mm-hmm. these mutated faces underneath. Oh, that was one of those things that stayed with him.
Huh.
And I think that's the fundamental point is when you watch these movies on some level, you should be uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
It should make you uneasy, and that was me at the same age as my 8-year-old. You know, when I saw the cartoon show, made me uncomfortable, and that's a good thing.
Yeah,
you know,
I'm getting caught up now in the visuals, but I completely agree. Yeah, that's sort of what I mean when it's like I don't feel like this. To use a monkey metaphor, I don't feel like it craps in its hand and shoves it in my face necessarily, but it's just, it's not reaching what it's capable of.
There's nothing remarkable about it.
No, because that's what I'm realizing as I'm realizing I'm getting a little bit caught up in watching it. So, you know, visually it is
certainly as a visual experience, but I think the problem is that when you call yourself Planet of the Apes, there is a higher bar.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and you know, we can certainly point to the sequels being of lesser quality in those original films. But the original, the 68 one, is almost universally acknowledged as one of the greatest movies ever made.
Right. When I think of this movie, what am I remembering? Like some of the visual things or action set pieces or whatnot. But when I think of the last film that came out, what was it, Rise?
Dawn of the Planet of the Apes.
Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. Like, I, to this day, remember, when I think of that movie, what I think of is how you have the apes and the humans meeting in the jungle and wary of each other, but thinking maybe we can have some sort of relationship. And then there's the one jerk monkey character. And
the one jerk human character.
Yeah, yes, yes. And just, I remember walking away thinking, like, damn it, like, we could all get along if there just wasn't those people, like the people that just have to be the dictators, that have to be the whatever. Like, and it made me think about humanity. Like, that's why there will always be war. There's always that guy, you know. And I like the feeling, like it evoked feelings and thoughts about the world
you know,
to me. And
there's a shot very near the end of that film where Andy Serkis as Caesar and Jason Clarke, they put their heads together.
Yep, I remember that.
And it's so poignant.
Yep.
Because you're like, this is the last moment where man and ape can, they could have been. This is what could have been. You know?
Could have been, yep.
And that's what Matt Reeves said. He's like, this is the moment where it could have been the planet of the apes and men.
Mm-hmm.
But because of just people on both sides, you know? And again, that's something remarkable because I have not seen that movie that much. I've only seen it twice. I'll probably be watching it again before... I've seen War for the Planet of the Apes, by the way, I should point out. So I have you at a little bit of a disadvantage. But, you know, I'm going through them again because I'm watching them with the kids. And you know, the imagery stays with you and the themes stay with you.
Very much so. I've only seen it once and I remember it quite
well. And that's
the
thing. And those themes are very much in line with what this franchise should be at its best.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So this is a matte painting pretty clearly.
Yeah, these exteriors right there of the city, I'm continually impressed by them.
So the Leo here is leading his little motley assortment here. We skipped over it in the plot, but he dove down to the remains of his pod and he got a little doodad that he thinks is taking him to like a rescue party waiting for him. And that's why they're going into the jungle, into the desert.
Right.
And that's why they're out here doing this. It's weird because the character stuff, I think, is not as effective as it could be in terms of showing why. So Helena Bonham Carter's character, she's sympathetic to humans.
Mm-hmm.
But the notion in ape society is that the humans are just animals.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not animals because they talk.
Right.
Right? So to me, it's like, you know, you try to find a corollary. Like, if your dog was like talking to you and hanging out with you and doing stuff for you, it would be like, oh, you're just an animal.
Yeah, yeah.
No, you'd be like, those are just different kinds of intelligent creatures, right?
What I'm not remembering right now, but the humans in this, they knew they could talk already, right? Because it was a surprise in the first one when he speaks.
Yeah, he's not surprising.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Okay, yeah.
He's just slightly smarter, you know?
Right.
That's it. I mean, it's like in the original film, if you remember, Charlton Heston gets shot in the throat.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right. That's right.
And that's the narrative device to keep him from talking. So now for a third of the movie, he has to prove his intelligence without being able to speak. I mean, you know, on so many levels, it draws you in.
Mm-hmm.
Here, it's just he's just, hey, what the hell's going on? Yeah. Where'd these apes come from?
Yeah.
How'd these monkeys get like this?
Gotta get out of here, right?
Yeah, that's basically it. So he's a purely reactive character. There isn't any the dramatic arc of I left the earth because I hate human beings so much. Now I'm back and I'm in the position of having to prove that human beings are worth a damn.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting. Like, you can see why Chuck Heston signed on for that as an actor.
Right, right.
Here it's purely, it's mechanistic. It's, I got to go from point A to point B to point C to point D. Now, this is the wreckage of the Oberon, which we, spoiler, I guess, we find that out in just a bit.
Yeah, but that's interesting, that shot. I mean, maybe it was intentional. It sort of mirrored the shot of him on Charlton Heston with the spikes of the Statue of Liberty and him on the horse.
You're absolutely right, yeah. Now, kind of interesting, the forbidden zone in this film is called Kalima.
Kalima.
Yeah, Calima. Now, I was reading about this. This is kind of interesting. Now, it's called that because there's a sign in the ship, and I think we'll see it in just a sec, where it says, caution, live animal. So, Kalima.
Uh-huh.
But here's what Bill Broyles said is he called it Kalima because in the Muslim religion, the testament of faith is called the Kalima.
Oh, damn it. Did I just do something offensive?
No, you didn't.
I was thinking simple, dude.
I thought this was really interesting because the Kalima, this is something like, as a Muslim, right? You say, you testify your faith by saying there's no God but God and Muhammad is the messenger of God. That's, mm-hmm. if for somebody to be a Muslim, that's all they have to say.
Mm-hmm.
It's an inviolable article of faith. So he called it right there. There it is right there.
Okay.
So he said he actually gave it that name because of its use in the Muslim faith as an inviolable article of faith.
Interesting.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
I was like, damn it. You made me like, yeah. you added this interesting thing in this movie that I hate, you know? So the whole idea here is that the secret history of this planet of apes is that, you know, they started out being caged, you know, test subjects, right? Mm-hmm. Who were hyper intelligent. Like they were being experimented on.
Right, right.
But I think the opportunity was there to go much deeper into that. The idea that the apes are being mistreated in some way. And, you know, like
why would they, like, rebel? They would rebel.
The idea that they're rebelling against something that was being done to them.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and we don't get a sense of that, and I think there was an opportunity to really go much, you know, have an indication of political unrest at home. Like maybe that's why they're off in space doing these experiments because there's ethical questions or whatever. And then, you know, in other words, there's an ethical cost that has to be paid.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Well, that's sort of what happens in the current series,
that's
right?
That's exactly right. Right.
Yeah.
It's man, you know, going into things he was not meant to know, TM and copyright.
Well, and then you have, what's his name? The kid from Harry Potter, right? Who's like poking and prodding at them in the cages.
I hate you. Yeah. It's my imitation of Tom Felton in that movie.
Right.
I mean, I think that the elements of race and racial unrest and all of those things that sort of underscore these films are glossed over. And I'm kind of like, if you're not going to use something like this to make points like that, then what's the point? Then you are just doing something kind of disposable, right?
Mm-hmm.
Planet of the Apes is not Star Wars.
Right. You know, it's not an action film.
It isn't. And so when you look at the success that the franchise had, it's like people didn't buy the toys and the lunchbox and everything despite the subtext. That was the reason. That was what they responded to.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it's kind of putting the cart before the horse. It's a little back asswards when you say, oh, we're gonna ignore all that stuff. And just have a movie with a bunch of talking monkeys in it.
Right. Well, and then that goes to, this isn't a new thought, but where they talk about like a four quadrant film.
Yeah.
Right. And I mean, at one point it was, we put out this movie in this month and this movie. And then in the summer we put out the four quadrant films, or the holidays we put out the four quadrant films, which appeals to young, old, male, female. Right. But now it feels like every movie, for the sake of business survival, has to appeal to everybody. So then many times they appeal to nobody, right? Because they're trying too hard to do too much.
And I think, you know, I mean, I remember like this right here, all the humans come and, you know, why? Because they've heard of this a human who defies the apes. And I know in some international territories, the marketing campaign was a hero will come. Right, as opposed to a hero will rise from
gladiator. Oh, really? Oh, literally those words. That's funny.
Yeah, and it's like that's not what this is, you know?
Right. People respond to that. I mean, that's from Gladiator, right? A hero will rise.
A hero will rise.
It's amazing how that has lasted. I feel like I hear that a lot.
And it's funny because I mean, you look at something like Gladiator, and well, Gladiator is not telling a new story.
Mm-hmm.
Right, Gladiator is Ben-Hur, and it's the Count of Monte Cristo, and it's, I mean, you name it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
There's so many, Gladiator is just a new take on an old story, but it does do something archetypal in its own specific way.
Mm-hmm.
I think that this film, like you said, they were striving for something that was four quadrant.
Mm-hmm.
And so again, from a purely marketing point of view, it makes sense. Mark Wahlberg, up-and-coming actor, Tim Burton is Tim effing Burton.
Mm-hmm.
And here's a property that people know. It's like it was put together in a boardroom.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was packaged in a boardroom. This kid, I just remember him annoying the piss out of me. There's a whole genre or a trope in movies called dumb kid.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
He's another part of the long line of dumb kids.
I was just out sneaking around loudly by the villains. I mean,
See, Mark Wahlberg, like every third shot on his face is just, what the hell's going on? Like in his head, like right there.
Yeah.
What are you supposed to do, Optimus? I mean,
yeah. The wind is chasing me.
I feel like
what's happened to the bees? Where are the bees?
Basically, why he signed on to do The Happening, right? It was like, oh well, Shyamalan's doing it. I'm like, you know, maybe read the script, Mark, before.
Right, right.
Just gonna put this out there, you know.
It's actually looking up trivia about this too. He's spoken ill of this movie afterward, and I remember he said the same thing about The Happening. He's like, when? What the hell was that?
Yeah. Like, I mean, on the one hand, you can't blame him because, yeah, a chance to work with, you know, such and such director, sure. On its face, it sounds like a good idea.
Yeah.
But maybe just read the script.
Right. It is interesting when certain actors will eventually break bad on the movies they were in. Like, it seems like it has to be a movie that's universally recognized as something no one liked. He's like, I'm just like you guys. I didn't like it either. You know? We're not so different, you and I.
I mean, I don't think anybody had a good time making this based on the talking. No, but nobody's like, ah, oh, yes. Planet of the Apes 2001. I remember that well. Like, no, nobody does that, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe she does, because that was...
I was just thinking that. Estella Warren.
We're, like, picking on Estella Warren in this
No, class. No, she's a model, right? I'm sure she's fine.
She was. As I recall, she got into some legal trouble a few years ago. Like, not like... like not shoplifting or something minor. It's like domestic violence.
Oh, geez.
Like she was abusing her boyfriend.
Yikes.
Yeah. So, you know.
So that is
that's
that.
That's the thing. That's the thing that happened. Yeah. So the character backstories here are only alluded to, but it's this the idea that this character Krull was a mentor to Attar, played by Michael Clark Duncan, but Attar decided to go and join Thade.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is all completely negligible to the story, but it's weird because it comes back into play later in the film in a really bizarre way, because Attar has a face turn, I guess you would call it,
mm-hmm.
that just feels completely arbitrary.
That's so funny. See, I don't even remember that.
Yeah, well, I just rewatched this last night, so.
You know, something else is interesting, completely unrelated to what we're talking about, is I looked this up. This is one of two films that Tim Burton shot in 2:35.
Oh, wow. That's interesting.
Kind of interesting. I'm always sort of fascinated by those decisions when people, you'll watch some sort of movie that is really big, an action-y film, and then they shoot at 185. I'm like, I wonder what the thinking was with that.
So what was the other film?
Mars Attacks.
Really?
Which I believe was right before this.
Mars Attacks? No, there was no. There was Sleepy Hollow before this.
Oh, you're right. No, yeah, Mars Attacks was 96.
96, yeah.
Yeah, I see. But nah, I always wonder when you hop around like that. It seems like you either... You know, you have a certain way you like to frame things, and you maybe sort of stick to it. Comedies tend to be like 185. Action films tend to be 235. I just wonder what the thinking is.
You know, what's interesting, though, I mean, you talk about Tim Burton. If nothing else, he formed a lasting relationship with Richard Zanuck after this film, because Zanuck produced almost every Tim Burton movie made up until his passing. You know, Big Fish and Dark Shadows.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. All the way up to that, huh?
Yeah. And that, I think that was his last movie, because he died in 2012. This scene is pretty kind of weird there.
Yeah.
I mean, Tim Burton, Tim Roth, sorry. He's playing it to the hilt.
Yeah. Dark Shadows.
Yeah. I'll be honest, and this might be heresy in some quarters. I've never been a fan of Tim Burton movies just because Tim Burton directs them.
Yeah, same. There
always has to be some other factor that gets me involved.
I completely agree with that, and I am a fan of the thing he does, but that doesn't mean I don't like the movies of his that I don't feel like land.
Yeah, and there's quite a few that don't really land.
Yeah, yeah, more than I'd like, but... I see, and that's why it almost, maybe even starting with this one, it felt like, or maybe Sleepy Hollow, it was sort of this thing where it's going to be this story you know, but through Tim Burton's vision.
Right.
And you're like, like Edward Scissorhands and like, I want to see that.
Right.
But then it became less of a tantalizing thing, you know, when it was, you know, like Alice in Wonderland. I remember even up into that, like Alice in Wonderland through Tim Burton. Okay. You know?
Sure.
But it's sort of lost its luster a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I think that he appeals to a very specific demographic.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't want to sound like I'm just piling on Tim Burton, but I think, generally speaking, I think that his perspective on things that I love, I tend to always disagree with.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even his perspective on Batman, to be honest.
Sure.
Because he's, you know, if you know, talking about the character, he's like, you know, to me, Batman, like, he's got to be, like, crazy, and, like, he wouldn't wear the suit unless he was insane, and, you know, it's like, I just don't agree with that, you know?
Yeah.
You know?
No, it's funny, because, and now I'm thinking again of, like, Miss Peregrine, which again, I liked. Yeah. But that is a story that is suited to his sensibilities.
Yes.
So he can thrive and have his vision and it matches what the story is, right? But like when he's doing a story like this that isn't really something that comes from his heart or his worldview.
Right.
Then they just don't, you know.
Yeah, and I think that's, you know, I think that's definitely illustrative of the problem here. You know, another problem this film had, by the way, is that they were racing to get into production before a threatened writer strike.
Oh, wow.
No, the strike did not happen. But that's always a bad situation to be in when you're racing to beat an arbitrary deadline.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to being like, well, let's just go at our pace, and if we beat it, we beat it.
That's funny because just recently there was a looming potential writer's strike, and then there were articles looking back at the previous one in 2007-08.
Yeah.
And it was an article talking about all the films and TV shows that were affected by it.
Yeah.
And Quantum of Solace was one of them, right?
Quantum of Solace, Terminator Salvation.
Terminator Salvation, Transformers 2, I think.
Which... did you know they had writers in that movie?
I know. But it is kind of fascinating. I mean, these are things that are supposed to exist and be memorable for years to come, but they just get affected by these outside forces. And
well, that's what's so weird to me. Like, I mean, I get it on some level because the studio is probably like, well, we've signed this talent. And like, there's a whole bunch of moving parts, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But the idea that... I mean, if this doesn't give you an insight into studio mentality, right? The idea that, well, the script, the most important, like the foundational element of a movie, we'll figure it out.
Right.
Sometimes that works. I mean, you know, The Fugitive, they were basically writing on the fly.
Yeah, sure.
And it turned out to be this amazing thing. But how often does that happen?
Right.
Right. And there's so many horror stories of that not being the case, that the idea that you, and especially when you have so much money involved, that you wouldn't be like, you know what, maybe let's take a knee and figure this out, you know?
Yeah. So rally the troops. A hero will come.
Hey, come on, guys. we got to beat these apes, okay? I don't see Mark Wahlberg as inspirational speech guy. Come on, Optimus. You're a good guy, right?
Right. Where I come from, we're capable of so many things. Building cars and TV dinners.
Well, let's get these apes. It's freaking great. I think he needs to start singing You Got the Touch.
Yeah. Didn't you say that your one of your sons started singing that the other day?
My 3-year-old, he's in the other room. You got the touch. You got the power. Yeah.
And you were joking, right? You're like, I hope he got that from the Transformers film and not from Boogie Nights.
It's Transformers or Boogie Nights. So it's a coin toss, you know?
Here they come.
Now it's barreling towards this big ape versus human battle, and again you make a contrast with the original film, which is the exact opposite of this big high stakes battle. It comes down to just a handful of people,
mm-hmm.
Discussion and discussion, right? I mean, bigger is not better.
Yeah,
and that's kind of the thing, right? It's when I look at this film, it's like you go down a checklist of things that people think are supposed to be in a Planet of the Apes movie.
Mm.
Well, we got to have ape slaves. We got to have, a battle of some kind and a spaceship. You know, you just toss them in and you're kind of like, okay, I guess, you know.
Mm.
It's like the popular perception without actually knowing what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Like if you were to ask somebody who's never seen Star Wars to describe the story to you.
Yeah.
They could probably do it. You know what I mean?
Right.
But it would be weird.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
And like the reasons behind things.
Exactly.
They wouldn't know what those are. They'd just be like, yeah, well, there's a fight.
Yeah. You know, they have and Darth Vader's the father, I guess, you know,
mm-hmm.
like certain things that, you know, because of just cultural touchstones. But that's, you know, we don't have, like, who are all these people, right? We don't have any stake in them.
Mm-hmm.
That's the weird. See this? There he is, dumb kid.
I was just gonna point him out. Yeah.
From now, I'll tell you, you're gonna notice this now whenever you watch movies. You're gonna be like, oh, dumb kid. Now I do have to give it up for the production design for these ape costumes.
Yeah.
They're all cool looking.
Organic.
Yeah, I mean it's very different from the previous version. But see, this I hate. I hate that they're like scampering
running,
across the desert like animals.
I think
the centrality of the premise, ultimately, you strip everything away, it's the idea that man could be brought low and become like a beast, and the beasts will supplant them and become like humans.
Right.
And the hunt sequence in the original film solidifies that.
Right. Whereas, may as well be men on horses.
That's exactly right.
Right.
And that, by the way, is what Boole does in his book. Pierre Boole, we maybe didn't mention his name, but you know, and he gets a credit in this film, by the way, you know, the original novel by Pierre Boole.
Mm. Also, is he in the latest ones?
You know, I haven't seen his name.
Interesting.
I was kind of wondering about that. Like, you know, doesn't his estate have some claim over this? Mm. Since it started with him.
Maybe possibly, but he doesn't have to be credited at the
possibly.
Top of the film or something.
I do know that the end credits of this film, they give credit to Rod Serling and Michael G. Wilson, which I thought was also interesting.
Oh, do they really?
Yeah. Even though, I mean, it's a vastly different movie.
It's funny. I mean, we should point out now that the apes are charging at the humans, and we've had the kid trapped under a horse for some reason.
Why? Because dumb kid.
Yeah. I'd kind of forgotten about that, so it's funny. Yeah, it makes even more sense why you don't like that kid.
Yeah,
my foot's trapped under something that I could easily get it out of. It's not like a rock or something.
Yeah, I know. It's try moving. Have you tried that?
Yeah.
See how that works for you.
So Wahlberg just shot off his boomstick.
That's right. Exactly.
Now the apes are like, what the huh?
Now it's interesting because at the time this came out, obviously, this was well after Titanic had become a huge smash. And at an interview at some point, James Cameron was asked about this, and he just said, "My version would have been very different."
So I can hear that in his voice, actually. So, yeah.
So throw in a little bit of shade.
Yeah. Now I have to return to my submersible and.
I mean, well, it's what I've read about the Cameron version is that it would have fit with the previous films.
Mm-hmm. Oh, like tied in.
Yeah.
So
because if you haven't seen the original series, the final film, Battle for the Planet of the Apes, ends in the year 2670. And it's shows we have a society of apes and humans that are sort of tenuously living together, and it's like a question mark. Like, what will, a thousand years hence, will we relive the events of the first film, or will it be different?
Mm-hmm.
So his idea was to go you're now back to the era of the original film, but things are different now because the time has changed.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of see where things go. And man, I mean, you can't... Clearly, Cameron... I can see Cameron being a fan of those films. So I would have loved to have seen, even if not directed by him, which it probably would not have been, but written by him or story by him to see...
Yeah, I would... Like I said, I wish he would do more of that. I'd be really interested to see... I mean, as long as he's going to be in an Avatar world, I would still like to see the other ideas in his head brought to life.
Yeah.
You know, whether he writes or produces or whatever. Yeah, this action is not terrible.
It's not terrible, but it's also not particularly memorable.
No. No, in particular, I was looking at that shot where the apes were running in the background, ape-like.
Yeah.
But sort of with dust around them. It was kind of an impressive image, actually. I read somewhere... where it was saying they pulled that off by putting them on a sheet that was being dragged. So
right.
It made them look like they were running faster.
What I don't like is seeing the apes sort of jumping around. In fact, I think we're about to see it right here with Helena Bonham Carter.
Like a high wire leap?
Yeah, like a crouching tiger style.
Mm.
Like that, right there.
Oh, yep.
It was goofy looking.
Yeah.
Because I don't think apes can do that.
Right.
I'm no anthropologist. I'm not Jane Goodall, but, you know.
That would be fun to watch. Oh, what I wouldn't give to have Jane Goodall as our guest on this commentary.
Just watching this.
Preposterous.
Jane, what did you think of that? Disgraceful.
Yeah.
All right.
And then every now and then we're surprised. She's like, amusing.
Arousing? Like, oh, okay. So right here, we have this confrontation between these two characters who it's like, this is supposed to be like Obi-Wan and Darth Vader.
Yeah.
Basically. But there's no, you know, there's no basis for it or anything. Because he's
it's funny when you say that, because I was like, well, you know, Obi-Wan, Darth Vader, there's a lot of context with that. No, that actually happened in one film.
Yeah, exactly.
And it meant something.
It meant something. That's exactly right, you know.
Well, and there's our crouching tiger leap.
Yeah, it drives me crazy. Come on, Shang Tsung. It's funny because Michael Clark Duncan was very, very prolific. I mean, for a relatively short amount of time.
Yeah.
It's extraordinary. Oh, yeah. I mean, because really, his big break was in 99 with The Green Mile.
Yeah.
Right? So, I mean, that's just 2 years before this. I mean, he very quick. I mean, he was in, I think he was in Armageddon.
Armageddon,
before.
Yeah.
But I mean, his kind of his breakthrough, like, because he was nominated for an Oscar for Green Mile.
Oh, wow. Yeah, but yeah, very, even if that movie isn't, like, you don't remember a lot about that movie, you certainly remember the images of him.
Yeah. I remember reading an interview with Rick Baker where he was telling them about, like, the type of people to cast, and he was like, you know, cast people with wider noses and who are a little bit taller or whatever, and he's like, and then they cast Tim Roth. Basically like the exact wrong physical type that he was looking for.
That's really funny.
But I mean, I can't think of another Tim Roth performance that's as sort of showy as this. I think for as much as I dislike the movie, I think he's always watchable.
Mm-hmm.
And he's always doing really interesting stuff. It goes to what Roddy McDowall did on those original films where, you know, in order to have your performance come through the appliance, you have to constantly be moving your face in all kinds of weird ways,
mm-hmm.
just to give it life. And I think Tim Roth is doing the same thing.
Yeah, for sure.
So this is the ape that disappeared. I mean, really, like, that. This is the thing, right? Why does this story all happen? Because Mark Wahlberg wants his monkey back. You know, I mean, it's so... what's the word? I don't even know. It's inconsequential.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They launched the monkey in the beginning and it accidentally went through a portal or something, right? That was the inciting moment.
There's like a distortion in space, okay? Mm-hmm. So they're like, oh, we need to check it out. And Wahlberg's like, okay, I'll go take a look. And they're like, no, send one of the apes in case something happens.
Oh, I see.
And that's his favorite monkey. That's Pericles. Mm-hmm. So the monkey goes through and disappears. So they're like, all right, well, never mind. And he's like, okay, I gotta get my monkey. And so the captain and the crew are like, dude, get back in the ship. He's like, no, I'm going to get my monkey. And then he disappears. So they follow his dumb ass through the thing. That's where if you're the captain, you're like, okay, moron.
Right.
See you later. Right? Because that's the whole thing, right? He bears the guilt because really this is all his fault.
Yeah.
Because they follow him through and then they, everything, it's all his fault, right? And that's why earlier in the film, he's like, this all happened because of me. I think we're breaking the barometer for how many Wahlberg impressions
in this
episode.
Thumbs up.
So the idea here is that, I had to read up on this just to get clarity, but the ape who overthrew the humans was somebody named Simos,
mm-hmm.
who is an ancestor of Tim Roth's character.
Wait a minute. So yes. There were already humans on this planet.
No, the humans were the ones.
Oh, they're
the
descendants of the people on the ship, right?
Yeah. As far as where horses came from, I have no idea. That seems like amazing.
You just broke the movie.
Yeah. I mean, unless they, like, why would there be horses on the planet? And why would there be horses on the ship? Like, it doesn't make sense.
That's funny. Well, and if that one ape had the punk teenager ape had a leather coat, where are the cows?
Where are the cows from? Exactly. No, no, it's pleather.
Ah. Yeah.
So, okay. So now, we see, it doesn't make any sense, but essentially Pericles returns, right? And so the ape prophecies say that Simos will one day return.
Mm-hmm.
Why will he return? We don't know. Right? It's completely arbitrary. Since Pericles is not a friggin' crazy ape, there he goes.
Ooh.
For some reason, Thade is upset about that.
Mm-hmm.
Why? I don't know. There we go. Crouching Tiger.
Yeah. Must have been. Well, this is like after the Matrix, right? Everybody's like really high on wire work.
And unlike the Matrix, about 90% of it looked like garbage.
Yeah. That was an interesting time, wasn't it? Where every action
Charlie's
film
Angels
after that,
did that.
What?
Charlie's Angels.
Yeah. Where they could do these insane floating action.
And I mean, when you think about it, the whole point in the Matrix is they have superpowers.
Right.
That's the reason they're able to do that.
They have power over gravity. It's a plot point.
It's a specific, right?
Yeah.
Oh, poor monkey.
Yeah. He polished the gun up.
Yeah. Well, that's
oh, that's
one.
His gun.
That's Wahlberg's gun.
Yeah.
So, at the time, they were, of course, thinking about turning this into a franchise just like the previous films. But I think this is one of those examples where they were thinking about a sequel before thinking about why there would be a sequel.
Mm-hmm.
And so?
How so?
Well, I think they were just like, we need to have a sequel. Why? Because you'd make sequels to Planet of the Apes.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is that there's not a story within itself that would justify a sequel. It just ends with a cliffhanger.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a particularly interesting cliffhanger. We'll talk about that in just a second. But Tim Burton, they asked him, would you want to do a sequel? He said, I'd rather jump out a window. And this is like very, you know, like during the promo process.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Huh.
So he had a not positive experience making this movie. Mm-hmm. And that's understandable because he was signed on while a release date had already been set.
I would like to hear more about that. What did he, so this thing exists and people feel sort of tepid on it. So what would he have done differently, or what did he want to do he wasn't able to do?
I don't know. I don't know that he's ever really talked about that.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, he signed on in February of 2000 and the movie came out July of 2001, which, I mean, it doesn't seem like an especially abbreviated production window.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know. Maybe you know better than me.
I mean, who knows?
I mean,
who
a
knows?
Year and a half seems like plenty of time.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd be really curious. We should kickstart a documentary called Searching for Planet of the Apes.
Right.
Where we interview all the people involved.
Hey, Tim Burton talked to that other documentary.
That's what I kind of had in mind.
We should totally, you know what?
That could be like a whole genre unto itself moving forward now, where we just get all these documentaries about movies that went wrong or didn't happen. There's a surprising amount of them in recent years.
And they're very compelling.
Yeah, people are, well, even as recent as the Han Solo movie.
Oh,
it used
gosh.
To be, you know, you hear about a troubled production and hopefully in 5 years you might get a tidbit of why. But then when the Han Solo thing went down, it was like 12 hours later we knew everything.
It was like CNN on the fives.
Yeah, I mean, that's just where we're at now.
Like 20 years ago, that was the level of coverage of like the Gulf War. Now it's like, you know, minute by minute updates of, what happened with a troubled production. So here, So the idea here is that Thade is trapped behind this laser-proof glass.
Mm-hmm.
And there he will be forever and ever until the end of time. Or will he? Question mark.
And man, he is going for it.
Yeah, so I mean, it's certainly fun to watch him. Mm-hmm. Him specifically.
Yeah.
So by this point in the film, I mean, I remember watching this opening night and being like, okay, this is not working the way I wish it would, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I can distinctly remember my feelings of like, because I was supposed to go with opening night with Sean and Paul, and they were going skydiving. And I was like, F you guys, I'm watching Planet of the Apes opening night. So I went with some of my cousins. And we got there late because my one cousin's a moron and he didn't get ready in time. So we were like the third row up. I still remember.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it was one of those things where I was like just trying to convince myself that it wasn't dull and kind of useless, you know?
Yeah.
I distinctly remember that sense. Like, I didn't go through that with Phantom Menace.
You just knew right away.
Phantom Menace, I watched it. I was like, this is not very good.
Yeah.
And I gave it a mixed review. This one, this is where I went through Phantom Menace syndrome.
Yeah.
Because it was a solid 2 months, I would say. I think it took until the movie coming out on home video.
Yeah.
For me to be like, I never want to watch this. And that's ultimately what it comes down to, right? I mean, you've said that before. Like, when you watch a Star Wars movie, you're kind of like, I'm going to be watching this, like, for the rest of my life.
Mm-hmm.
And this comes out, and I'm like, I'm never going to watch it.
Yeah.
And from the time it came out to now, I've probably seen it, including this time that we're watching right now, maybe 7 or 8 times.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 4 of them being in the theater back in 2001.
Yeah.
You know?
Remember that when you'd go see a movie several times in the theater and when you're like a teenager? That was fun.
I remember watching Spider-Man in 2002, like, I don't even know how many times.
Yeah.
It was just like, I'd be driving home from work and I'd be like, I think I'll go watch Spider-Man again.
Cool. Yeah, exactly. You know? And I mean, movies were a lot cheaper then. I remember Jurassic Park is the movie I've seen the most in the theater.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. I mean, it was just like, want to go again? To my brother. It's like, sure.
Why not?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, these days I'll go once, you know, for like a press screening, and then I'll go with the kids, you know?
Right.
And that's usually about it.
Well, here we go on, we get a little kiss here.
Yeah, I mean, they're basically, you just have to imagine that Tim Burton was forced to cut out the sex scene. That would have gone
right.
You know?
We see in the deleted scenes, like, want to get out of here for a minute?
Yeah.
like, no, Tim, no.
it's interesting because the kiss between them is like more romantic than, like, for example, when Charlton Heston kisses Kim Hunter at the end of the original Planet of the Apes.
Yeah, her reaction in that one is more of like surprise, right?
Yeah, she's like, you're so damn ugly.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Which is, it makes it funny. I read how Paul Giamatti talked about at the end of the film, originally his character Limbo was supposed to kind of become a good person because he's kind of like a Weasley con man.
Yeah, right.
And then him and Burton both decided that, no, he should be an asshole at the end, too. So he's, like, giving kids drugs, basically.
Yeah.
But it's weird because he's like, who wants to buy some aspirin? It's like, well, why would you know what aspirin is?
Yeah, good point.
Hey, I like the ape better, but I guess I got to kiss you, too.
Yeah, yeah. He did have this, like, oh, yeah, you. All right.
Here we go. She's like, do you still want the ape, Mark
yeah.
Wahlberg? This movie is Mark Wahlberg Talks to Animals, by the way.
Wait, what? You know, oh, yeah, the SNL thing. It is funny. I do still kind of makes me chuckle at the end of the original when he's just like, come with me. Like he's, or like the woman comes with me.
Yeah, right.
kind of reaction to it.
Well, come on. If you had this scantily clad woman looking like her, just following
well, on this planet with
Yeah.
Like no other human. Absolutely. Yeah.
That's right.
No, for sure. Like
that's the right reaction.
They'd be like, do you want, you only have room for her or food on your horse. I mean, it's easy.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll learn to appreciate soil.
So here we go. So this is now the ending. They did not have an ending figured out for the movie. They just knew they needed something to compete with the Statue of Liberty.
Right.
Now, how do you compete with that, right? It's difficult because that's one of those endings that's iconic for a whole host of levels, not least of which being that it's a perfect summation of the film.
Mm-hmm.
Here, it was like, well, we need something shocking and, something that lays the pipe for a sequel. And Tim Burton said as much. He's like, I don't know why the movie ends the way it does. I figured whoever did the sequel could figure it out. that's a quote, you know?
Yeah. So, see, I mean, it's funny, though, too, because at this point, you, as the audience, have to assume that some sort of twist is coming. You're almost beholden to have a twist here.
Because of the property that you're in.
Yeah, which is no enviable thing. I mean, with the other ones, we were saying, you know, they sort of, we don't have to do that because it's a different approach.
Yeah.
So, and now is this any way similar to the book or related to the book?
Well, that's kind of the interesting thing, right? Because the ending of the book is that our hero returns to Earth from the planet of apes, and it's been however many hundreds of years, and then the Earth has turned into a planet of apes in the interim.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, this is the ending of the book.
Mm-hmm.
However, the problem is that they added this extra wrinkle of General Fade being a part of this, right? And mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think there it would have been very easy to have the ending be effective by get rid of that whole General Fade aspect of it. Have something in the beginning talking about unrest on Earth, talk about, you know, something alluding to what's happening on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And then we see, okay, so right here, what the hell's going on? That's the
pattern. That ain't right.
So right here, so the Abraham Lincoln is now General Thade's face. And yeah. It says there in the back, the memory of General Thade is enshrined forever. So why General Thade?
Yes. Yeah.
Right, just have it be an ape. So now, imagine he sees an ape, it's not Thade, he runs back to his ship, he looks at the chronometer, and it's like 500 years after he left, or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's like, what the hell? And then we see all these apes come. And then, so mentally, you're like, you make the connection. You're like, oh man, he was gone so long, and the same thing happened on Earth. And that is maybe not the most satisfying, but at least an ending.
Yeah.
It brings the story to a close, right? But what this does is it seeds a story point that will never be resolved. So you're like, well, I don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And literally the DVD set, when this first came out in 2001, came with a little card that explains the ending.
Really?
Yeah. So it says that here's Earth, and here's Ashlar, and Leo leaves on this date, and he returns to Earth on this date, and somebody else left Ashlar on this date and got back to Earth sooner.
So basically, that's kind of funny. Like something that's a bit of a plot hole, they're like, just throw a card explaining it in the DVD.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
So basically, what we have to assume then is after Leo Davidson leaves, Thade escapes from that little place he's in. He fixes Leo's ship that crashed in the water, took it to Earth through the time portal, landed on Earth at least before the Lincoln Monument was built, and changes the past. Well, that's a lot of legwork to have to do to arrive at a not particularly satisfying ending.
Right.
You know, because the, see right there, it says the theatrical motion adapted by Wilson and Serling. I've never seen a credit like that. I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
But the 68 movie ends and it's like, oh my God. Oh my God. Right. That's because you take in the implications of it. And had they never made a single frame of footage after that movie, it's a complete experience in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
And look at Rise of the Planet of the Apes. Had they never done anything after that, you've still got something that stands on its own.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the problem with this film is like, oh, we'll figure it out in the sequel. Well, what sequel?
Right, right.
You've created an inherently unsatisfying experience that will ensure that nobody wants to see a sequel, which is what ended up happening. The movie did really well financially. That's kind of the interesting thing.
Mm-hmm.
Fox did not take a loss on it. I think globally it made something like $350 million.
Wow.
So it did well. However, you have to give it up for them having the foresight to say, you know what? We should take our chips and leave.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because there isn't enough here to make a sequel. I mean, there's plenty of films nowadays that do well. They make a sequel and the sequel doesn't do well.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Or even trying to course correct in a sequel, but just saying, like, let's just start over.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
You know? So I think that's you know, shows some kind of foresight that Fox had. Because I can't imagine a sequel to this would have done well.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it all worked out. I mean, similar to that we say, I mean, I don't think this is on the level of Batman and Robin. But without Batman and Robin, we wouldn't have had The Dark Knight, so...
I think so. And I think, by the way, when we talk about the development or rise of the Planet of the Apes, it tells you everything that the initial seed of an idea was not, oh, hey, we should bring back Planet of the Apes. It was, hey, you know, it'd be an interesting story, something about a chimpanzee and blah, blah, blah. Hey, that would be a good Planet of the Apes movie.
Mm-hmm.
But it started with the idea first, separate from the franchise.
I just have to call this out just because it's, I think, somewhat interesting. But the people that, you know, they call like a loop group where they have background vocals and people like, oh, he can talk, oh, you know, in the background.
Sure.
That's usually run by a person. And there's a woman named Barbara Harris. And I saw that she was the person who ran the loop group on here. And she has done everything.
Really?
Everything. And I worked on a movie with her. And I got to meet her and she was super nice. For Your Consideration, the Christopher Guest movie.
Oh, okay.
And so, you know, you have these 5 or 10 men and women in there, and you'll have, you know, some sort of press conference or something, and they're doing all the voices because those people aren't mic'd, those extras playing reporters. Then they have people like, you know, Captain, da 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 da, blah blah blah, you know, just the walla and the things going on in the background. And I enjoy looking at credits of older films and just seeing like, man, she has touched everything.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, she's prolific, and nobody knows who she is.
Well, I'm glad that you took the time to point her out.
Yeah.
So Brian, revisiting this movie, you saw it, you and I, we both saw it 16 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
You probably have not thought much about it since then.
No.
What do you think about this film now? Because at the time you had not seen the original Planet of the Apes either.
That's correct.
So,
right.
So you have a little bit more, I was going to say appreciation of the franchise, but if not that, awareness of the franchise. I don't want to presume. What are your thoughts on this?
I just sort of what I said in the middle. I was a little. I've caught dribs and drabs of it on cable recently, even, and it's one of those things where I now sitting here watching it from start to finish again. I was pretty impressed with the visuals of it. So I mean, I do think I can see why it made a lot of money and it was popular at the time because it was something to watch. I mean, it is something to take in, but I can see also why the story doesn't feel, now that I've seen the previous ones and what they have done with the new run that they're doing. I mean, the things that I think about with those films aren't even the visuals necessarily. They're what they make me feel or think about.
Yeah.
So I can see why this movie was popular in the moment, but why it hasn't lived on or why people don't think back on it or even think, in your case specifically, like, fondly on it, people who are fans of the series. So it's you know, it's a well done physical thing, but I don't think it's particularly memorable.
Yeah, it is it's an attempt to sort of piggyback on the goodwill that people had for a beloved franchise without really adding anything unique and memorable to it.
Yeah,
it's kind of the aftermath of the Planet of the Apes.
yeah.
Which, if those of you who don't know what aftermath is, Google aftermath. we'll be talking about MASH soon, by the way, Brian, you and I.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
On an upcoming future episode of a podcast, not our podcast, but we'll talk about that soon. But we will also be talking before too long about War for the Planet of the Apes, Brian.
Yeah, very much looking forward to that.
I think if you have enjoyed those films up to this point, I think you will enjoy them. And they will do the job of removing this one even further from the forefront of your memory. I think this is a film that it exists as part of the franchise, and that's why it's worth sort of commenting on. I think it is a much lesser thing to emerge with the name Planet of the Apes than anything else, in my mm-hmm. opinion. But I enjoyed having this discussion, and I hope those of you listening got something positive out of this. Certainly, I think the development process and everything tells you how valuable a brand this is for Fox.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I appreciated you sharing all this stuff. I'm always fascinated in movie development because there's an infinite amount of versions of any movie that could exist. And it's always fascinating learning how we get to the thing that we're familiar with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that wraps up this commentary track, but we will be back soon with a couple more. We got some big ones planned in the next couple weeks, which I'm looking forward to sharing with everybody. Mm-hmm. On behalf of my colleague Brian Hall, I want to thank everybody for listening. If you do have any comments on this podcast commentary, you can leave them on our Facebook page, facebook.com/moviefilmpodcast. You can also email us at moviefilmpodcast@gmail.com. We've gotten some great suggestions for future commentaries, and keep those coming.
Yeah, I love doing these.
it's a lot of fun, and you know, Brian and I love to chat anyway, so chatting through a movie is that's not work for us.
Yeah.
As I say all the time, go to iTunes, go to Stitcher Radio, leave a review, leave a star rating. Every little bit helps, so let people know what you think of the show. Even if you leave just a one-word review at iTunes, that's going to help us out, so please do that. And we'll be back soon with an episode of the regular show and another commentary track before too long. So thank you, everybody, for listening.
Welcome, friends. It's the Movie Podcast. Enjoy the show. Zachy and Brian are talking about the movies. Movie Film Podcast on the radio.
For the ones who get it done, the most important part is the one you need now. And the best partner is the one who can deliver. That's why millions of maintenance and repair pros trust Grainger, because we have professional-grade supplies for every industry, even hard-to-find products. And we have same-day pickup and next-day delivery on most orders. But most importantly, we have an unwavering commitment to help keep you up and running. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
With the Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18+ terms and conditions apply. See website for details.